We acknowledge that we are on the traditional land of the Duwamish tribe. We honor them with gratitude. We also recognize that Green Plate Special is a white-founded organization working alongside many Black, Indigenous, and people of color communities. We see our privilege and take responsibility to use it to support our community and work towards a more just society. Welcome to Together in the Kitchen. I'm Anya, and today we are doing something a little different than normal. We are making flatbread art. And for flatbread art, it is essentially, we're gonna be making the dough for the flatbread, and we're gonna be decorating it with veggies, seeds, nuts, and anything else we can find in our kitchen. And it's gonna be a creative, fun process. Another aspect of today's episode that is a little different is that we have a special guest joining us. Educator, colleague, and friend, Maia!
Hi everybody, I'm Maia, and I'm so excited to join you in the kitchen today.
So Maia and I are going to be decorating some flatbreads together, slicing some veggies, and getting the creative juices flowing. So let's get into making our dough first. Now we're gonna get into our dough making. And for folks who've been a part of GPS summer camps in the past, you might recognize this recipe. This recipe is essentially our pizza dough recipe, but instead of topping it off with sauce and cheese, we're gonna top it off with the veggies and make a pretty picture. So for this recipe, you can use all-purpose flour. Right now, for this video, we're using a double zero proof flour, which is just a flour that they tend to use in pizzerias, but all purpose, it works just the same. And then we have dry activated yeast. We have sugar. We have salt down over there. And then we're also just gonna need water that is lukewarm, a little cold to the touch, not scorching hot because we don't wanna hurt our yeast. So let's get into getting our water. So for this recipe, on camera, we are going to be having the recipe. However, in the description box, that's gonna be the recipe in its whole, in its entirety. So right now, we're just gonna fill up one cup of water opposed to two. And with this, like I said before, we don't want our yeast to, you know, die or get hurt or not bloom in our water. So we don't want it to get it too hot, but we also don't want to get it too cold. And so with that, we're gonna actually do the elbow test. And what the elbow test is to make sure that you know the right temperature of your water and that it's not too hot or too cold. It's because the nerves on your elbow are not as dull as the nerves on your fingertips that you touch everything with throughout the day. And so usually don't touch your nerves on your elbows so much. So we're just gonna turn on the water. And so see, I was already ready to do that with my hands, but we're actually gonna wanna stick our elbow in, and I'm feeling that it's okay. I feel like it can be a little warmer. Now a little colder.
2 hours later.
There we go. I think that's just right. Okay, so now we're gonna put our water into our big mixing bowl. So now we are going to bloom our yeast. First, we need something for the yeast to kind of feed on. So we're gonna add some sugar. And right now I have a half a teaspoon of sugar. And then we also have some salt because we don't want our dough unsalted. And for that, I'm gonna do 1.5 teaspoons of salt. I forgot half a teaspoon. Still looking for it. Here it is. And I like to put the salt and sugar in first and then the water, just so it can get nice and dissolved for the yeast. I'm gonna do that 1 cup right there. And then I like to sprinkle the yeast in just gently. And we're gonna stir with a wooden spoon for 5 minutes until the yeast and everything else is fully dissolved. And you will start smelling it too. It's gonna smell a little funky, but that's how you know that the yeast is blooming. Okay, so as stated before, this is half the recipe and the description is the whole recipe. And for half a recipe, it will fill one of these smaller baking trays. If you wanna do a full sheet on a baking tray, then you'll do the whole recipe and that should just be just enough. So for our flour, if you're able to do this, there's a method called a scoop and swish. And what the scoop and swish is that you just take a scoop and you pile the flour high in the measuring cup. And you can pile it as high as Mount Rainier or Mount Tacoma. And what you're gonna do, what I like to do, is just pop a little bit, get some excess falling off, and then you're going to scoop and then swish right over it, just so you get the exact amount of flour and that it's nice and even and there's no holes or gaps underneath or in the measuring cup. And so we're gonna do this method when putting our flour into our yeast water mixture. So as stated before, we're gonna do our scoop and squish. This is my first cup. Pile it high like a mountain. We're gonna do a tap, tap, tap. Also, fun tip, what I do, because I don't have a flat edge where I live and I don't have a scoop, is that I just fill it up. I just essentially do this, fill it up really high, and I take a Tupperware lid and I tap, 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 and then swoosh with the Tupperware lid. And that works just as well. So this is our first cup, and after our first cup, I'm actually gonna mix and incorporate the dough a little bit so it doesn't stay all clumpy. And then as you're adding the rest of the dough, you wanna add it gradually. You don't wanna add it all in at once because then you'll be prone to more clumps that you might have to knead out, and it'll just be harder for the flour to incorporate in general. I'm gonna stir that, and then I'm gonna move on to my second and third cups. We've added our third cup, and right now our dough is just about good. I'm gonna actually stop stirring with my wooden spoon and take some of this excess flour, get it on my hands, and just get in there and use my hands to incorporate the rest of the flour into the rest of the dough ball. So don't be afraid to get your hands dirty. And don't stress if there's extra flour along the edges. That can be used as we're kneading on the table. You don't want to throw that out. That's perfectly good flour. And so right now I'm just slowly incorporating the flour in, and it's getting a little sticky, so I know I still need to incorporate it in. Okay, I think this might be ready to knead on the table. So I'm just gonna take my dough ball out, and I'm just gonna dump my bowl and sprinkle a little flour in there. I don't have any other dough scraps in there. I'm just gonna put it on the table. We're just gonna knead the flour. And as I'm kneading, I'm also trying to chop some of the flour inside just to incorporate it. And another tip, which I don't know if this is a GPS tip specifically, or if this is just a old baker's trick, of when you're kneading the dough, you want your dough ball, I kind of like it a little like an oval, and you fold it, and you press, and then you switch to position. So I guess you switch it, you can switch it counterclockwise or clockwise, and then you fold it again. So fold, turn to the left, fold, turn to the left. And that's another way to knead our dough and get our flour incorporated. And again, if you start seeing dough on your hands, I like to just rub my hands together, get all that excess dough off, and make a little dent in my dough and put all that excess dough in there so it can not go to waste and be used. So I'm gonna knead this until the flour, I mean, until the dough is no longer sticking to my hand so much, and which will probably take another like 2 to 5 minutes, and then I want to let my dough rest. I've kneaded it enough. And then we are then going to knead it again after the resting 10 minutes. I kneaded my dough. I think it's at a good stopping point to let it rest. It took about an additional like 2.5 to 5 minutes. You know, it has a lot of flour incorporated. It's not really super sticky. And I'm just gonna leave it in this bowl, and I'm going to put a cloth over it, like so. Just hang on. I'm gonna put a cloth over it to let it rest for 10 minutes, and then we're gonna proceed kneading it until it's soft to the touch.
Okay, so when I'm prepping my veggies, I want to keep in mind that I'm going to be using them to create a picture, like Anya talked about before. So I kind of, in my mind, want to be thinking about what might be most useful to kind of arrange on top of my flatbread, like a work of art. So for my tomatoes, I think I'm going to just do whole circular slices. And for this fresh tomato, for slicing this, I'm kind of using my chef's knife going back and forth in a sawing motion so that I don't smush my tomato or it doesn't juice everywhere. So that's one option for your tomato. Let's see, Anya, do you have any other ideas of how you might want a tomato for your flatbread? That's a great idea. So I think maybe for longer wedges, I'll cut it in half that way. And then I have a flat side here, and maybe I'll just saw through. Is this what you're thinking of, Anya?
Yeah, something that can kind of be like maybe lips if you want to do a
portrait. Ooh, I like that. Yeah. Cool. So there's my tomato. And then similarly for red onion, well, first I'm gonna take this peel off, so I'll slice off both ends. Put it on its flat side. Just gonna slice it down the middle. Take the peel off here. And oh, I could have actually kept it whole and just sliced it into rounds. Oh well. So I'm just in the groove here with this onion chopping. Well, you can cut it into strips. I'm doing them kind of wide so that I can use them to decorate with. And you can, you know, pull these apart a little bit so that you can spread them out on top of your flatbread. So that's one option. And then you can also sort of keep your onion together and like fan it out, which is gonna be an experiment. Let's see how we would do that. What would you recommend, Anya? Should I cut it in half first again, or?
When you mean by, I was thinking maybe to keep this, sorry, my hands are a little floury, to keep this cool, like swirl.
Oh yeah.
Right there,
mm-hmm.
You could just do, you know, thin slices and mm-hmm. just be very careful. You can get those cool C's.
Yeah,
maybe
okay. Let's try that too. Here's our little.
Have to very slowly.
Let's see here. So kind of thinly, and then keeping them together like whoop, like that. Is that what you're thinking of?
They look like purple rainbows.
Oh my goodness, they do. You could even still use it as a whole circle if you wanted to, like that.
Okay, so our dough has been resting for 10 minutes and you can see that it's a little bigger than what it was before. And now we're gonna knead again until the dough is soft to the touch, until these little ridges are gone and it is soft like a
like your forearm.
Like your forearm. Okay, so I am forming my dough into a nice circle and I've kneaded it until it's nice and soft. I can poke it just to see and how it's coming back to me. And now this is the point in the recipe. You're gonna have to wait a little bit and wait until the dough can expand and rise. So what we're gonna do is that you can get a container. You can also use a bowl with saran wrap if you don't have like a Tupperware container on hand. What you're gonna take, you can take the spray olive oil, which we know doesn't really spray. So, ooh, now I've started to a little bit. But I'm gonna coat the bottom of my container. Then I'm gonna take my dough ball, place it nice and gently into the container. I'm also gonna spray the dough ball so it doesn't dry out when it's expanding and rising. Now, we're just gonna put our top, our lid on it, and you can leave this rising from 24 hours to 2 days. So you can use it after 24 hours, you can use it, you know, 2 days from now, but past 2 days, you're gonna wanna freeze it, and you can use the dough at a later time.
Okay, we are ready to stretch our dough. We've got a sheet pan here with some parchment paper, and I'm gonna actually just spray the parchment with some olive oil. Oh my goodness, that came out all in one. Oh, it's not really spray anymore. Look, we can draw with it, that's cool. Well, I guess I'm gonna use my hand then to spread it around. Usually it comes out like more of a spray and you can just, you don't have to use your hand, which is what's convenient about the spray, but if you are just using olive oil out of a bottle, this is kind of what your process would look like, using your hand to rub it around. And this is so that our dough doesn't stick to the parchment. And it'll also make the bottom taste good with that olive oil flavor. Okay, so here is our dough. It's pretty soft, but as you can see, it's not like totally soft. So I think the easiest thing is to just put it right down on your pan, and then you're gonna use your hands to press it out. So I'm kind of going out with one hand towards you and then towards myself at the same time to stretch it. Whoop, parchment is moving a little bit. And I'm kind of going out to the corners as well as just up and down and to the sides a little so that it fits into this whole pan. And we want it to be a little bit thick, like thicker than you would think for a thin crust pizza. More like focaccia or ciabatta or something, like a thicker bread. For extra flavor, I'm gonna put a little olive oil on top of my dough as well. So I'm gonna spray it and just use my hands again to spread this olive oil all over the top. And I'm also going to sprinkle a little bit of salt on top. Just a little bit to give it some extra flavor as well, since I'm not gonna be using a tomato sauce, but you could use a tomato sauce. And I'm not gonna be using cheese either, so using this olive oil and salt is gonna give it some extra flavor. If you did wanna use cheese, mozzarella or Parmesan or cheddar cheese, anything you have around would be great on this flatbread. And as far as other veggies go, feel free to use anything that you have on hand, even if it's just like one or two different vegetables for this recipe. I think broccoli would be really tasty, or even eggplant if you saute it ahead of time. Maybe some kale too, that would crisp up really nicely in the oven. Anything that you have lying around would be great.
Okay, so Maia very nicely spread out my dough and put some olive oil and salt on it. Thank you, Maia.
No problem.
And it is time to decorate. This has been the moment that at least I don't know if you've been waiting for it.
Oh, definitely.
But we're gonna make some pictures. So let's get into it.
Wow, what a blank canvas. What are you gonna start with?
I don't know, I'm kind of overwhelmed. I was thinking how much I liked how these looked for eyes.
Oh yeah, uh-huh.
But then again, I really like the leafiness of this parsley and how it could be like a nice little, like, you know, flower landscape situation. Oh, I could just place things down on here and I don't have to commit.
Wow, it's like easier than painting.
Yeah, no commitment, sign me up. Okay, so I'm gonna play around.
Okay, I'm gonna do the same.
Okay.
No mistakes, you know?
No mistakes.
I kind of like the way that these onions are. Maybe I'll make a sun. But, I mean, I don't know. I might want to do something more abstract, too. Not really sure yet.
Ooh, I think that sounds good. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. So, as you can tell, we've been working away like true artists, and these are our masterpieces. I don't know, Maia, do you want to talk about your masterpiece first?
Sure. So I kind of started with this sun shape here. I used the thyme as some sun rays. And then I figured I would just do some, like a flower picture. So I started with these mushrooms as soil, sprinkled some rosemary as like some grass and shrubs. And then I just used these garlic chives as like the stems for my flowers. And then just got creative with trying out different seeds and shapes of veggies. Some of them I kind of stacked on top of each other to make this sort of abstract flower garden.
I really love it. I really love your idea with the soil and the rosemary. It's so cute.
Thanks. Tell me about yours.
So I decided to lean into the portraiture. I decided to create a face. It's not based off of anybody in particular. I used some of the garlic chives and the onion chives and the parsley for hair. And then the olives for eyes. Some bell peppers for eyebrows and ears. Some onions for the nose and like the shape of the head. And these beautiful tomato slices that Maia sliced so great before for lips. Nice, luscious red lips. And then I thought they needed some accessories, so I made some earrings out of sunflower seeds and olives, and I was envisioning this as like a turtleneck situation. So some zucchini for like the bulb or the turtleneck, and then some sorrel just for like the, I guess the knit underneath. And to top it all off, some sesame seed freckles.
Wow.
I don't have a name. If you have a name, if you have a name, comment it, you know, down below if you have a name for this, the both works of art. And right now I think we are up to the step of putting it in the oven for around 10 minutes. And you're gonna probably wanna watch these to make sure that things don't go too crispy, but I think they'll be okay for 10 minutes.
Let's do it.
We are done. We took our flatbreads out of the oven. There's some things that have changed, some things that have stayed the same, but I think it's safe to say all in all, these flatbreads look beautiful and they have a lot of personality, you know, and vegetables even changed a little bit that we didn't expect. So I don't know if you want to do like a nice little tilt up reveal. So I'm going to cut into mine. I think I'm going to cut an earring off. Thank you, flower person, for being such a kind person to allow me to cut into your earring. And feel free, you can just put your hands on it to get a better grip. Okay. And yeah, our dough cooked nice through. Look at those little holes in our dough, nice and squishy. Ooh, this looks really good. So, Maia, do you want to cut into yours and see how it looks?
Oh, sure. All right, let's see. I think I want to try maybe some of my soil down here. Whoops. Brown, lightly brown on the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Looks really good. This would be really nice to, Emma suggested dipping it in olive oil, maybe some balsamic vinegar in olive oil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and feel free to like, you know, if you want to add other things besides veggies, like meat and cheese, go for it, you know. I'm sure some cheddar orange hair would make these flatbreads look pretty cool.
Some pepperoni ears, maybe.
Yeah, oh yes. Oh, yes. So, Maia, thank you for joining me in this
episode.
Thanks
so much. Yeah, so happy to be a part of it.
It's been a lot of fun, and who knows, we might start a flatbread series on the GPS YouTube channel. So this has been so much fun.
Send us your photos of your flatbreads. I can't wait to see what kind of pictures you make.
But for this episode, we'll see you next time. Thank you for tuning in to Together in the Kitchen.